Good afternoon, all of you. Most respected Dr. B. N. Suresh, Chancellor IAST. As being this very important program as part of our Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, we are having Dr. B. N. Suresh delivering this very interesting talk, Advances in Aeronautics and Astronautics in India Since Independence. As all of you know, the strides we have made in aeronautics is really very unparalleled and significant, not only in space sector but also in aeronautics sector, spanning across the commercial, defense, as well as other industries. The changes which are happening currently in this sector in creating new avenues and enterprises is to be seen with regard to what has really been accomplished so far and what is there in store for the future. So today the listeners are IAST, especially the faculty and students, and we being an institute with a greater focus on aeronautics and astronautics must be fully aware of what is really happening. I think this awareness is what Dr. Suresh, I am sure, will convey through his talk. And we have to organize ourselves internally with regard to taking up activities to become part of this great movement which is taking place in aeronautics in this country. So without taking any much time, let me invite Dr. B. N. Suresh to deliver the talk, and also to thank him specifically for being with us today, and also request our faculty, students to take best advantage of whatever he is speaking, and also identify the niche areas that you will be able to contribute to this sector through your research, your work, your future assignments, your entrepreneurial capability, your startup capability, or whatever that you can do to keep this activity flourishing in this country. So with this, let me thank Dr. Suresh once again, and over to you, sir, for your talk.
Good evening. Thank you very much. Sri Somnath, Director IAST, Director VSSC, Dr. YVN Krishnamurthy, Registrar IAST, Professor Chandrasekhar, Professor Kurvilla, and Deans, Heads of the Department, faculty members, and all other participants who are attending this webinar, and my dear students. First of all, let me convey my warm greetings on this Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, 75 years independence. That's why I have chosen the topic that aeronautics and astronautics, how it has advanced in the country in the last 75 years. That was the idea. And I'm just putting my presentation. Is it available now? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Is it coming full screen?
Yes.
Okay, good. Basically, even when I joined ISRO almost 5 decades back, nothing much had happened in astronautics or aeronautics. But then since then, the way in which things have progressed in the country, it is phenomenal. And IAST itself is being essentially an aerospace organization, both in science and technology. I thought the faculty and student, they should know really how things have progressed. The progress which has been made in the last 5 decades, you can see that it's really stupendous in aeronautics as well as astronautics. I'm going to cover the whole range of areas like aeronautics, defense, space sciences, as well aerospace education. And while presenting, I will come to the space later, because most of you are part of Indian Space Research Organization and very familiar, but you may not know much in what has happened in aeronautics and defense. And I had the privilege of getting involved in many of these programs almost last 20-25 years in different capacities. And I was able to sort of get the needed materials from our colleagues and friends in different organizations. What is important is, being aeronautics and defense as well space, attaining this total self-reliance for the country is very important, because these are all considered as the strategic areas. While we have achieved in almost all other areas, one area where we have to make big headway is the civil aircraft. I'll come to that a little later. And aeronautics, you know that particularly the fighter aircraft, it took a little longer time, no questions about that. But today it is one of the very fine birds available in the globe. And it has become really, you know, what they call 4.5 generation. It's a world-class aircraft. And today they are working on several advanced developments. I'll come each one by one. Now coming to the defense, our striking capabilities today has multiplied. In fact, you might be reading every now and then nowadays, one or the other missile is being launched or missile is being inducted. So there are a number of them. I will just give a glimpse of that because time is the premium. Of course, the Brahmos, it's actually the Brahmaputra and Moscow rivers. You know, that's how the Brahmos' name has come. And it's one of the advanced supersonic missile. Along with Russia, we have done it, and it has tremendous striking capabilities. And today, they are seriously considering to sort of export it also. Of course, the progress in space is really phenomenal. You know, that is, I will come to that later. A whole range of services are being given, like remote sensing, communication, navigation. For want of time, I'll give you just a glimpse of that. And so also in space sciences, you know, already we have achieved a lot by three important missions, Chandrayaan, Astrosat, Mangalyaan, and also tell you in brief what is in store for us. While these things are happened, in fact, you know, in the last almost 3 to 4 decades, the expansion has happened in the education sector too. It is really manifold. Today, I think we are able to prepare the young scientist or engineer to meet the aspirations of the aerospace demands. It's happening. Now, let me go one by one. Look at the fighter aircraft. I think you would have heard about the light combat aircraft. You know, I was quite lucky to participate even during the design phase. And I was a member of the test review board, and most of the things we know. And also at VSSC, we were fortunate enough to undertake the development of quadruple redundant servo actuator. And I'm very happy to mention that today it has been almost accepted. They are just have to have a flight test, I think, which will come very soon. As I mentioned, it's a 4.5 generation aircraft. Today we are in the 5th generation. And you know, what is amazing is so far they have done more than 5,000 flying sorties. Absolutely no problem of any kind. So that is something unique, the way in which the design has been done. And for India, what is important is, you know, we have extremely hot and extremely cold weather because all our operations are in the Himalayan region. I think you know why. So it becomes very important. That's why to get an aircraft to function in this kind of wide variation is quite difficult. And also it has to operate day and night operations. And of course, these are the specifications on which one has to do that. And this has very, very sophisticated sensors, as you can see, GPS-based navigation, weapon aiming suit, multi-mode radar, all these things are there. So multi-mode radar has a wide variety of application with weather radar capabilities. And what is important in this kind of combat aircraft is you should have a provision to have the air-to-air refueling. In fact, on right top, you can see that the IL-78 tanker is refueling. That is the one which is shown here. And this is what you see on your left bottom is the light combat aircraft in the air show. In fact, it has become one of the very good systems. And it has a fantastic controller, what we term as the advanced autopilot, with critical altitude recovery, disorientation recovery. This, in fact, it was debated in the initial stages, and it was almost decided to go for the Boeing Aerospace to get the control development. But then at that time, Kalam was the chief of defense, scientific advisor to Raksha Mantri, and he was the person who took decision, and I was also part of that decision at that point of time. And today, what is important is in all these fighter aircraft, the man-machine interface is something very important. And unless you have a controller which operates very well in terms of man-machine interface, they don't feel compelled to operate this aircraft because they are all very highly agile and maneuverability is very high. With all that, the testability and all that, you know, what is important is absolutely no fault of any kind has been seen anywhere. This is really a fantastic achievement for a country, and all of us should be proud. And it was not easy to make services to accept it. The Air Force finally accepted, and you know, they have ordered for 83 aircraft at HAL. You can see the cost that is involved, 48,000. If you have to import, you can see the cost that is involved. And what you see here, you know, the middle one, this is where the combat missile, the missile is attached on the belly and trying to really utilize. And this is the, they have generated a separate IF squadron on LCA program. So this is something very interesting. Now, while that has happened, we have a requirement for launching and landing on ship because, you know, the war cannot happen only through land. It has to be in all things. But it's a very, very difficult job to develop a Navy version for the simple reason the runway available is very short. So, you know, it has to have a different techniques. What is important, you know, what you can see here, the sky jump takeoff, what they do is at one end of the ship, it will be having a slope, sloping upward. Can you see here? This is the one. Because once that happens, it will jump up and attains the altitude. By then, the system that is available, control will have enough time to stabilize and take it forward. If you just take off like land, then you will never make it. This is what is called as the sky jump takeoff. And at the same time, while coming, because runway is very small, you can't really come to halt. So they have a very, very, you know, tricky job. What they do is they have the high strength wires which are there. As it lands, it sort of identifies and it will try to hook under the aircraft. You can see here, you know, you can see at this point there's a hook. It just gets hooked at that point and then holds it as if you are holding from the bank, and then it tries to decelerate and bring us to the halt. So that's why the futures are in terms of how do we have the sky jump takeoff, how do we have the arrested landing. Very tricky job and it's not that simple. So, but at the same time, you can see that both this the sky jump as well as the hook system brings in tremendous amount of shock on the system. You can see that any aerospace system, when you have the shock, the design, the, I think people who are working in this area, they know in terms of the vibrations and the shock and many things that bring in. And also it requires a totally different field of view for the pilot. That's why there is an optimum head-up display so that, you know, when all these things are happening, they must have the very good visibility so that the wider field view is available, as well as because nose is drooping, the visibility is very good. That's why it brings in enhanced field of view for the carrier landing. Of course, here also one more important thing is, you know, the aircrafts for some reason it has to go finish its job and then come back. But then at times for some reason they have to come back for some known reason in the battlefield. Then it becomes important, you can't come back with fuel being there because it has certain amount of fuel and there is a requirement to jettison it. So in order to have a emergency landing, so that is what is required. And of course, the refueling capability is given here also. In fact, this is sort of almost a prototype has been built and then it is undergoing testing. And they say that this will be ready for launch. This is one of the very important capabilities that we should have. Now, next comes slightly enhanced naval version. What I shown was a smaller one. And here what we do is they go for a twin engine deck based fighter. This is under development, and this will be inducted, you know, as per the projection by 2031. Of course, here also almost similar operation, excepting that, you know, it has to operate in our carriers, which are there, INS Vikramaditya and IAC C1 carrier. And here also, the because it becomes little heavier, the difficulty, as I mentioned, you know, this is how it is defined, stowbar. I think I have written here very clearly, so that what does is the frontal part of the deck is elevated. It has to form a curve. For curve also, there is a definite the angle at which it has to come out. And it have a sky jump, but it brings the upward movement. You can't have a very high movement or you can't have very low. It has to be optimal at that point. And what is the height it gains is equally important. Once that happens, the engines with afterburners, there are afterburners brought here, it sort of generates the required thrust to stabilize its flight. It's all easy said, but then to see that it happens, it is a quite a difficult job. Then of course, the, you know, on all these aircraft, what is important is how do you carry the weapons? This is called store. You know, how do you really store the stores in it and operate? And when you operate, you know, that also gives some a certain amount of shock, vibration, and many things. And it comes on very quickly. The fumes come. There are many issues related to that.
Okay.
Then, you know, it also, there's a requirement of advanced sensors and avionics suit integration, because whatever we have learned, they are trying to improve. And this requires higher power. That's why they are going for it. I think somebody's. Hello?
Hello, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now somebody is keeping the mic on, please. The I think.
So requesting all of you, please.
All, please mute it.
Mute it.
If the disturbance comes, you won't know whether I am audible or not.
Sir. Now it's okay, sir. You can continue, sir.
So you know this propulsive thrust. That's why they are going for a high power. It's a general electric engine. I think many of you may know that the development of the engines meeting this requirement is a very tough job. And in spite of our 3 to 4 decades effort, we are yet to become successful. So we continue to import the General Electric. And of course, it's optimized for air to air and all other roles. So this is something, one version which is being done. This is a medium weight fighter. You know, this is same LCA only on which is for air. It's called Mark II. One earlier explained was Mark II. The advantage here is you have to have a long range and long endurance. And of course, it goes without saying how much I can carry extra payload with heavy standoff weapons, you know, because how many weapons you can carry, that is also extremely important. And of course, it has multi-role capabilities. And in order to do that, you require a host of avionics. Again, for want of time, I will not be able to dwell on that. These are all very, very complex areas. And I know that people who are really, you know, taking courses in avionics, courses in aerospace, all that, you can see the amount of effort that is required to put them together and make it work. Then, of course, they are sort of have a quick turnaround. This is very important. Comes, finishes, goes back. And you can see the host of new technologies have been brought here. For example, the cockpit. It is a smart cockpit, really, you know, with lots of improvements have been done. It's very important for pilot to have all the comfort so that he doesn't struggle to do the various operations, the visibility and his reach, his hand, all the aspects you have to consider, his comfort ergonomically, all these things one has to do. And of course, the higher thrust engine comes. And similarly, you know, this is completely electronically active radars are being used. But what is important is, I think, you know, again, I will not have time to explain in detail, net-centric warfare capability. What it means is, it's a complex combination of, they are all combined, devices, information and services, and they are interconnected by a communication network, so that you sort of utilize the resources that are available they are optimally utilized or for the optimum benefit. And also various events which are there, they are all well synchronized. Because there are, you know, this is highly agile and moves so fast, and you have to really synchronize the events. Otherwise, any one event is not synchronizing, you get into problem. This is the one which is called AMCA. I think if someone has read today's paper, particularly Hindu, the chief of air staff has told, he has given a lot of prominence to this AMCA, Advanced Medium Combat Aircraft. This has tremendous capability, and they are looking forward that this will be inducted into the our Air Force. What is important is, you know, this has the very sophisticated stealth technology. Stealth technology means, you know, you are not able to really see that. So how do we do that? In order to do that, this brings a tremendous amount of capabilities in terms of, you know, you have to have a trade-off between aerodynamics and stealth. Stealth demands shaping it in such a way, any radar signal that is coming, it gets reflected and doesn't go back. So that's how the stealth is achieved. And of course, the absorption also on the surface, the signals, they get absorbed, it doesn't reflect. So that you use that stealth technology. Now, in order to do that, you shape it in such a way, but the moment you shape in different form, the aerodynamics becomes different. And the shapes are really funny, then how do we really manufacture, build the structure? Can you see that? The kind of interaction that is there in achieving this. And that's why it becomes extremely difficult to design a stealth, because it is shaped so that radar signal is reflected away from the radar equipment, and the airplane is to be covered by materials that absorb radar signals. So these are the two important elements that makes it stealth. And also, once you have this, and you know, it also has to enable the enhanced lethality and survivability. Both are important. It is going to be able to go and attack and also survive and come back. So, you know, the what we term as the electronic warfare, when it is there, all these things become very important. How it is done? One is the stealth airframe. I know this possibly will take decades to come out with the right airframe, but then, you know, I was very lucky to participate in the designs and reviews. Even today, certain reviews I attend that. It's something amazing to sit and listen to those people. Of course, the pilot vehicle interface, this is, I told you, this is something we are not facing. Even in the human space mission, the man-machine interface is there, but not as cumbersome as the pilot who is there. You know, they have to take real-time decision. Then there are number of sensors, and data fusion becomes important. And you have both active and passive sensors. And of course, the net-centric warfare, I told you, the communication network is built such that you are able to assimilate all the data. Then of course, the carriages for weapons and store. Again, this also you have to make it really see that the stealth property is brought. But what is more important, you know, this is red dash shown here. It's called divertless supersonic inlet. Basically what it means is, you know, the air intake is taken through a serpentine duct, because it is almost at a very high velocity, but then you have to bring down the velocity at the when it comes to the engine. You can't take the same air at that velocity and make it function. So in order to do that, what you do is you design the duct. This is where the aerodynamics people again and fluid mechanics people, they come into a big, you know, the design challenges will come, and then they have to bring down that velocity, whatever is there, to the velocity that can be accepted at the inlet of the engine. That's what is important actually. Then of course the advanced integrated sensor suit, they are all combined and integrated. That's how it comes. 360 degrees enhanced situation. That means, you know, you can't have any leeway anywhere. It has to cater to the whole range of things. Then of course all these, this is important, integrated vehicle health monitoring. You know, the IVHM, it has come in a big way, and LCA has been used, and even our Gaganyaan friends at VSSC, they have been seriously considering utilizing this. This becomes very important. And they call certified enhanced devices design. CED, this is almost similar to what we use as the COTS technology. So you can see that while you have a one range of complexities, you also have to bring down the cost and make it reliable. That is important. Of course, you know, one can go on and on. The time available, I'd like to finish. Now, the progress in firepower, missiles. See, basically, it was going on for long, but then the real thrust came only when Dr. Kalam took over as the director, Defense Research Development Laboratory. Of course, you know, our loss is gained by DRDL and DRDO. 82-83 he joined, and soon after he joined, he brought some kind of total systematic way of working. That means guided missile development program. It's called IGMDP. There was a board, and I was also a member of the board for quite some time. You know, the way in which he brought out, and Venkatraman, incidentally, you know, was the defense minister. He supported fully. And he brought out five important missiles. They are called Prithvi, Agni, Akash, Trishul, Nag, very interesting names. Ballistic missile, which is something, you know, which can go far off distances and destroy, is called Agni. Okay. Then surface to surface, that's called Prithvi. The short range, low level surface to air, it is Trishul, almost like what Trishul does. Medium range surface to air, this is codenamed as the Akash. I think now, even I think the day before yesterday, I read Akash Prime or something with a variation they have launched, and it has become very successful. In fact, today they have a wide range of missiles for different categories. And this is called third generation Nag. You know, just like Nag, it can go and destroy anything. Now, once you have this, you see the kind of classification they can have is short range ballistic missile, roughly 100 to 1000 kilometer. This is all in battlefield, you have to worry, SRBM they call. Medium range, 600 to 3000. Intermediate range, you know, this depends on how our enemies are there, where they are located, what is that you would like to do. It's called IRBMs, intermediate range ballistic missile. This is something I think everybody is worried about, that intercontinental ballistic missile. One thing is, you know, all these things, they come under the real embargo because they are the dual use. That's one of the reasons launch vehicle and missile, you know, we are in real difficulty. Anything can be used for anything. That advantage is there, also disadvantage. This is more than 5,500 kilometers. You know, you can go and hit anywhere in the globe, really. Then, of course, it is not enough to have the launch only using the ground. You use submarine. So that's why it's called submarine launch based. It just comes, you don't know where it is. Submarines are down and it has a tube in that the missiles are kept. And just like that, it keeps coming. That's one of the reasons you should have more and more powered submarines. I think nowadays you would have seen that nuclear-based submarines are what happened with Australia. They're trying to get it, and it's all under embargo regimes. But then because they are nuclear power, they can go down deep into the sea. And without your knowledge, it will start coming actually. You know, the lethality, you can see that. Then, of course, in the missile, another classification they have, you would have read here and there, tactical missile. Basically, they are short range and used in the battlefield. So that's why, you know, they go in different kinds of silos, mobile and all that. Strategic missile, basically, they are long range, and also they are targeted even for short range. If there are some big installation you want to destroy, because they have that very high power destructive capability. Now, strategic deterrence system, you know, Agni series. Agni, you can see that 1, 2, 3, 4, and finally 5. This is the one intercontinental ballistic missile. I think you keep hearing every now and then being tested. I think sometime back they tested one. It was successful. And this is, again, you can see that submarine based. It just comes from sea. You can see that somewhere down below it is there. They have identified as a K series. This is also same thing. Again, Prithvi, it can go anywhere, either on Navy or ground or whatever. And you can see this is from ship, really, Dhanush SB or SRBM. And you can see the whole range. Only one point I would like to mention is the first one, what you see here, the Agni one, This is the first one Dr. Kalam initiated, and because of his connections with ISRO, the same first stage what we used in SLV3 was used as the first stage of Agni. In fact, we were all part of that, the who were involved in, you know, I was involved in the control of the first stage as fin tip control. He took it as it is and with little changes here and there in the interfaces that was used. That's how he involved all of us from our launch vehicle area in different ways during the initial phase and then accelerated. This is what you see is the, you know, this is where they do the launches, Wheeler Island. And I think now they would have named after Kalam, if I'm correct. This 19th April 12, they started. Since then, they have a number of launches. Now, tactical missile, I told you, basically, they have to be quick reaction and a solid propellant. And maneuverability is something. They are all highly unstable systems because the maneuverability is something very important. Also, they have to function all-weather capability. And second thing is, you know, your storage should be very long. They are all kept in silos, maybe 6 months, maybe 1 year, maybe 2 years, and different places. But when you really press the button, it should operate really. So you can see here, this particularly, it's called MRSAM, that is mid-range, a high response, quick reaction. It can, you can have it at vertical or at an angle, depending on what is that you would like to strike. You can see the kind of the systems that are built to launch. It can move anywhere and then stop. They are all loaded, and from that you launch, depending on the range that you are willing, actually. So they are called basically the air-to-air missile or air-to-surface missiles or surface-to-air missile. You can see that. These are all different variations that are there with the different ranges. And what you see here is the belly of the aircraft, and you can see how it is loaded with the ammunitions. And there again, a lot of, you know, engineering calculations are involved. If you want to hit a particular point and or if you want to hit an object, this itself is moving at a high velocity, and you have to sort of identify where to release it so that it still goes. Otherwise, no point in simply release whenever you want. You have to have an aim and then hit it. You know, that is what is important. Now, I think you can see this. This is another bunch of missiles which is kept there, Pinaka, and kept in a stand. And you can sequence and launch it, whichever sequence you want. Can you see here? It's what is there. This is guided. In fact, this becomes much more precise, a new technology by itself. And this is like this. You have, again, multi-barrel system, and it's also possible to have certain angles and then go in different directions, actually. And these are all surface to surface, depending on the requirement. What is more important, you know, in terms of technology, again, these are all re-entry point it comes. So that's why you have to have a very good thermal capability in these systems. And by and large, they are all solid motors, actually. This is, you know, this entire thing, what you see on your right is the BrahMos, what I mentioned. This is indeed very powerful missile that any country can love to possess, BrahMos, and basically supersonic cruise missile. And you can see the road mobile, you can take anywhere and launch it, or you can have air launch. This is in Sukhoi. Sukhoi has the capability. You know, whenever we get aircraft, the payload capability, what it carries, in fact, the cost that comes for an aircraft is not just aircraft. It is the kind of capability it will have to carry different kinds of missiles, which has its own complication. That's all not in the public domain. I think you would have heard a lot on this debate and discussion in this area. And it is a ship. You can see that at inclined as well as the vertical. These are all done BrahMos, and today it's a very powerful. And you can see that this is a surface to air missile, and you can adjust the angle depending on what you want and then launch it. This is really belly of the aircraft. That's why this photo has come like that. You know how the ammunition has been mounted on the belly, and then how do they release it from the aircraft. So I will go to just one or two areas. Again, time is the premium. Missile defense system. You know, this is something very important. that how do we really avoid any missile coming and hitting us? Question is that there are two possible intercepts. One is in the atmosphere, it's called endo-atmospheric, and another is outside the atmosphere, exo-atmospheric. So basically, below 100 kilometers is considered the endo-atmosphere. But only problem here is, you know, it has to depend on the ability of the passive infrared system operating the Earth's atmosphere, because it has to sort of ensure the signal-to-noise ratio, otherwise it will get into problem, because homing and intercept are very important. These are all very complex technologies in terms of your signal processing, then your communication, all these things will get into problem. But once you go to exo atmosphere, beyond 100 kilometer, by then it would have attained a very high speed, becomes faster, and it brings its own unique challenges, because it has to really aim the lock on to your enemy and then go and hit it. See, this is what it really means, two-layer defense system. You can see here, this is the one which is coming as a missile which is likely to come and hit us. Before it hits, you can see you have number of defense system built here. Again, you have the advanced air defense or exo-atmospheric, and you can see the kind of attempts it can make and destroy. Here you can see that it just destroyed here. Of course, it has its own complex, the radars, the positioning, the seekers, all that is a whole host of things are there. And you have to sort of build the missile. You can't use anyone you like, because it has to have a different sensors, then its speed with which it has to move has to be there. Seeker has to be very powerful and able to go and intercept it. Even the minute difference, it will not strike the missile. This is where the difficulty comes. That's why how do we really design the system is something very unique. This is, I think some of you would have read that, our own satellite built, and then it was only to try out how do we really attack the rogue satellite, it's called, because there are satellites which are built to create problem. So once we know, it has to be done. I think this again, the capability, this was taken on a truck, and you can see it has its own silos. From that it comes the solid motor, and after reaching certain altitude, you can see that the heat shield is separated because it comes out of atmosphere, then able to lock on to the satellite. The difficulty is satellite is moving at such high velocities. This velocity is moving, and it has to go and then sort of strike at the belly. That is the whole thing, and all your associate elements like radars, the positioning and the onboard calculation software. This is the one which was used in the experiment. It's a three-stage interceptor with solid rocket motor. And you can see this is the IAR seeker images they got. You can see that it's able to track, go nearer, and then here strike, and then whole thing has got destroyed actually. What is important is, I think we have become the fourth country to master this technology in terms of, after US, Russia and China. Of course, it created its own problem in terms of debris and all that, but then somewhere you have to master certain technology. This happened on 2019. Now let me come to the civil aircraft. This is the area where we haven't done much. Of course, we have been doing a lot, but then we are not able to cater to the requirements of the nation today with the smaller cities and towns are to be connected by bigger cities, what is called as the Udaan program. So you need something like a 90 to 100 seater aircraft which has to really cater to that. We have been working, and today you can see that our aerospace knowledge, we take the Hansa. I think some of our ISRO friends recently, we had discussions, I mean IAST friends, we had recent discussion to see that whether we can go for all electric aircraft. This is the one which is available. Today it works on the engine. We want to use the all electric, and some debate and discussion going on. SARAS I will show you just now. This is advanced light helicopter again built by HAL. Tejas I already talked. This is intermediate jet trainer aircraft again by HAL. If you really look at it, Today we have the complete design certification. Now certification is something very complex, unlike our systems, missile or launch vehicle or spacecraft. It is a third party certification, and unless they agree, because it's a humans involved in that, it becomes very difficult. And of course, I would say that we have the technologies and work centers in the country. They are a whole range of them are available. We have the experience in integrating flight testing. Precision manufacturing becomes very difficult. Today, I think we are quite good at it. Of course, skill set, regulatory authorities on this, you know, that is another. I think all these interfaces have been brought very nicely. This is something I would like to just show. You know that arrow option has gone, that's why it is
Earlier it was working.
No, I'll just rectify it. I think I have to do here, just bear with me.
Okay,
this is Saras aircraft in 2018. No, that's one of the very interesting aircraft. This is where we are trying last 6 years, at the Indian National Academy of Engineering. We have been pushing very hard. We have met almost all people who matter. Only thing is we are yet to get access to Prime Minister. Otherwise, almost everybody we have met, and they feel that it has to be developed, and approval is almost round the corner. What is important, you can see that, you know, completely it's a combined effort of CSIR, DRDO and HAL. This is how we have been proposing, of course, all other R&D institutions and in the, as a country. And whatever is shown in pink is the kind of expertise available in NAL CSIR. And whatever is shown in yellow is the one expertise available in DRDO, particularly ADA and ADE. And of course, the blue, whatever is shown, is in HAL. And of course, as I mentioned, the engines are to be imported. We are trying to import from Pratt & Whitney Center. This only tell you that we have the capability. Lot more work has done. The volumes and volumes of design reports have been generated, but we are yet to get approval. And we are hoping that one day we would get the approval. So what is that? We are not just talking. We have sort of made tremendous progress in various technologies. You know, for example, the aerodynamic configuration. The aerodynamic configuration, the optimization, CFD, whole thing, this has been made. Layout study, structural configuration is there. Then architecture, even all mechanical, electronics, avionics. What are the various power plant options? Then reliability analysis, environment. The airworthy requirements have been worked out. Infrastructure is there. IT infrastructure for digital mockup has been done. And also we have been discussing with the potential international design house. You know, this becomes important because you can't develop an aircraft civil and then tell people that you are offering. There has to be a buyer, right? So in order to do that, you have to have some branded international design house, and their name you have to attach. Then only it's possible. Even if they come and then like Make in India, they do, I think we are okay. Then of course, at the same time, you have to come out with the production roadmap that has been done, cost estimates have been done, a whole host of things have been done. Now let me come to the last area. Here I have the luxury of going a little fast because it's known to many of our colleagues here. Of course, this is the summary as on date today. We have made 81 launches, and starting from Sounding Rocket, SLV, PSLV, etc., including the space recovery experiment, reusable launch vehicle technology demonstrator, scramjet testing, that is hypersonic regime, then of course 113 satellites in communication, remote sensing, navigation, etc., they are all done. I will give some details. What is important is, see, we have launched 342 satellites from 34 countries. You name a country, they are there. Basically, there are CubeSat, Nano, commercial satellite, and then Universal. They are all, this is the work. And this is the only slide I have on the launch vehicle development because time is more important. See, this started in Sounding Rocket. This is the one Dr. Kalam sort of was the project director. And you know, the first one didn't succeed. First, very, very small error in one of the walls in contamination. Otherwise, it would have possibly gone. But this is the one where we learned the whole host of lessons, how the rocket technology is mastered. Because, you know, that's why it's called rocket science. And you have to face problems, you have to face failure and learn from it. I think entire game, in fact, first one failed, second one failed. After the second one, it was a very, very tremendous amount of efforts. And it took 4 more years for us to have the third launch, that too third launch successfully. So again, I don't have time to explain, but then whole host of things we learned in this. After all that, we thought, you know, we are very good. These are all the operational launches, PSLV, GSLV, and Mark 3. In fact, here we are having success after success, excepting one or two so far. And here also in the very first maiden flight, we thought we will be successful because we learned all the lessons. But what we didn't understand is the software complexity became an order higher from here to here when we migrated, because you know, we brought a number of onboard computers, completely navigation guidance control was there. And again, one simple error that also had manifested during one of the simulation tests, but then possibly we didn't analyze, but then it failed between the, at the start of third stage. It was a colossal loss for us really. And later on we found by simulation, all other system functioned. If you had not faced that problem, again, maiden flight would have been successful. Anyway, that's how you learn things. Then of course, GSLV. Then this is, you can see the, initially we used the Russian Cryo stage, and now we are using our own indigenous Cryo stage. And this is the one where we announced these two are for communication, this for remote sensing. Of course, this fellow does all kinds of missions, you know. They have a wide range of missions in different orbit. Today it's called workhorse. It can do anything. Now, this is the one today. So far we have been very successful, and where Chandrayaan 2 also went, and this is where we are looking to go for the human space mission. And you can see this is the human space module with the escape system and all that. This is the one I was discussing in Chile with the director of VSSC, that when are we having the small satellite launch vehicles. Very, very sort of attractive proposition they have come out, a design, and this is in a low Earth orbit and at very low cost and quick turnaround time. And in order to handle, of course, we have today 2 launch pad and one more third one is being talked, but then one has to see. And this is the control system, total mission control center. And these are all, just wanted to tell you that the facilities that are available, they are really world class, you know, in the space fort. Now let me come to the spacecraft, how it has really progressed. One thing India has done is they have gone on based on the thematic application. I think many of you may know that when I say thematic, like land and water resource management, the whole lot of thing, whatever is there, land use, land cover, water resources, crop acreage, horticulture, a number of them, you can see that. So over a period, they have developed both the microwave as well as the optical, number of them, they are there. And the second one is cartography and large scale mapping. I have not shown the whole range here for want of space and not to clutter the slides. You can see that cartography series which are there, like infrastructure development for road, rail, irrigation, pipeline, route alignment, urban master plan. In fact, this is even being discussed, I think 2 days back, that Amrit and other projects, Prime Minister, phase two, he inaugurated, and cadastral level mapping. Similarly, they understand the coastal and ocean studies. We have a series of ocean charts. Basically, you can see that this is something unique in the sense, you know, the way in which the ISRO has done to ensure that development of the country is accelerated. I think these spacecraft, they are playing a very, very vital role today, and every satellite is planned based on the thematic application. Now let us move on to the communication navigation spacecraft. You can see that how the evolution has happened. The first decade of 80 to 90, 90 to 2000, like that you can see till 2020 and beyond. We all started in a humble way with the Apple and InSat series, and you can see that migrated to InSat 2 series, brought more and more indigenization. Then we moved on to 3, 4 and GSAT series. And of course, the payloads also, we brought more and more indigenous systems. And of course, the IRNS series navigation, a unique, I will show you a picture on that. Then also, you know, the very heavy spacecraft also we have brought. And self-reliance is the key. In fact, we can see that the technology developments have happened over a period in each one of them. And of course, today further we are talking the high throughput satellite, high density, and also completely develop our own payload. So it's so prevalent in the country today, you know, direct to home is entirely serviced through ISRO satellite, or we hire if the capacity is not available. This is, of course, the telemedicine, tele-education, all of you know, and radio broadcasting, a whole host of things. In fact, the communication has made a revolution in the country. This is a very unique, I think most of you may know, but what is unique in the sense, you can see that it is a 7 satellite constellation and able to completely cover the India, you know, the entire region of India it's able to cover, you know, that's what is shown here. Not only that, it can go a little beyond that too. And today, in fact, it is being used and it operates in L5 and S band, and the accuracy levels are pretty good. You know, it's something like better than 5 meter, and time accuracy is better than 40 nanosecond. And the kind of operations it can do, it's very widely being used as fleet and logistic management in the country today. The GPS they were using, now the receivers have come, the combination of GVS and NAVIC both have come, and then more and more it's being utilized. And with that, the amount of savings it gives to the country is phenomenal. You can see that there are whole host of things that it's able to do, and that is what is shown here, the utilization, what's happening. And it is increasing day by day. And what is also, there is a thinking to enhance its capability, and maybe as the time progresses and if the country wants, we can even go global over a period by building system. This is just to give an idea, because it's yet to go and expected to be launched, as Director VSS mentioned, sometime before the end of this year. It's a very, very simple system, actually, 3-stage solid propelled, and you can see all like a pencil it is, and whole thing can be done in a matter of a couple of days, whereas we take such a long, and it can be launched on demand. In the sense, you know, I come and ask you to have a small satellite to be launched, I think from cupboard you can take and then do it. Almost that similar kind of thing, actually. And of course, it also has the flexibility to have the multiple. Why this is being done is, you know, today there is a tremendous increase in the small satellite rather than big satellite constellations. So it is going to grow exponentially. And having said that, it becomes important that we should be in the picture. You know, we can't really go on assembling 20, 25 days PSLV, put this satellite and do. I think it should be like a factory. where the satellite after satellite of different kinds cluster it and launch it. This is what is going to happen, and I'm sure that this will bring a lot of excitement to our youngsters. Now, what is in store for us for a launch vehicle? You know, this is also well thought of. Today we have a launch on demand and small satellites which is there. We have the PSLV, GSLV with the variations in the propulsion, because we can, we have the cryogenics, semi-cryogenics, they are all around the corner. The thinking is there to augment it. The human space mission is being done. So basically you can see that from 10 to 500, you go to 8 ton at 4.5 ton in GTO, then enhance it to heavy, then become super heavy. This is where a lot of debate and discussions are going on. But the technology developments have been initiated in terms of semi-cryo and other things. So they are all, basically they are available. Question is, we have to sort of firm up what is the route path, route we need to follow and take it further. So not that one good thing in space department is any time you look at it, they have something like 5 to 10 years, the technologies, the programs, the roadmap, they are available. So you can, that's why, that's one of the reasons you can see here, the various other new technology, reusable, and then the two-stage to orbit, all these things, they are there on the drawing board, and certain people are working in this area also. The question is, when do we really go? This is, of course, you know, I have to mention this, otherwise this is also sort of going in full steam, and you can see that from here it will be launched and then put it into the 400 kilometer LEO orbit, and then it will be there maybe 2 days, 5 days, maybe 1%, 2%, up to 3 it can be accommodated, and sort of you deboost at some point of time and then bring it back there. This is already, we had done two such experiments with space recovery, as well as the same module we brought called CARE along with GSLV Mark 3 in the first experimental flight. So all these things have been done successfully. So you can see that deboost, and it comes and lands somewhere on the east of Gujarat. That's what is being planned, and whole recovery will happen in 15 to 20 minutes after the deboost is happening. And you can see that this is a very, very important thing. But what is more important is the launch vehicle, you can't use as it is. It has to be, the reliability has to be increased tremendously. That is what we term as human rated. You know, I mentioned about aircraft, almost similar kind of reliability you have to bring, and then bring it, which means, you know, we can't afford to get into any problem of any kind. The space science missions, you know, you can see that Chandrayaan, Mars Orbiter, AstroSat, in fact, it has given tremendous amount of science to the complete globe. You can see the, I will not delve into that, because all of your, you know, what is important is water molecules of endogenic origin found in, this is something unique which Chandrayaan 1 has done. And similarly, the presence of hot argon in the Martian exosphere. You know, it's not that we are doing just for fancy. And of course, AstroSat has brought number of inputs. And I think that's where, you know, more than 70 publications have come. Here we did very well in Chandrayaan 2, accepting the final soft launching. And I don't think we need to get disappointed on this thing. That is why it's called space. Okay. And after we know the problem, I can tell you maybe another 1 hour I can spend on each one of the failure. When you analyze and see, ultimately the problem is only very simple. That's why the word I'm using, very simple. I don't want to use silly, because it's not silly. It's simple, but missed our attention. Okay. So attention, in spite of all of us putting our head together. So these things do happen. I don't think we need to get perturbed on these kinds of matters and learn by difficult process all over the world. But if you really look at our own space program, I think the kind of success that we achieved is something remarkable compared to many other nations. So that way we are very cost effective, conscious of reliability. And I think the systems, engineering systems are good. And you can see the future missions, Aditya, Chandrayaan 3, Mangalyaan 2, then of course Venus mission, ExoWorld is being talked, and of course IAST is a part of this. And you know, we need to look at these things. Now this is almost last slide. Aerospace Education India. I can tell you that when we started way back in almost 5 decades, really there was nothing much on aerospace. Today, you can see that there are more than 59 aerospace engineering institutions, and they give something like 110 courses. There could be more, but then dealing directly which feed into the aerospace system. And prominent among them are, this is not mine, this is sort of presented by one of the professors of IIT Bombay. He presented to NASA, American Institute of Astronautics and Aeronautics. And in that presentation, I picked up this again. He said, 5 old IITs, IASC and IAST brings it. I think it's a proud moment for IAST, I must tell you. Really, in the aerospace, we have done. You know, this is where I keep telling that we must come out of our mindset of being one of the educational institutions. I think we are also equally good, and today the IAST has done extremely well and it has reached that level. Otherwise, we wouldn't have figured in this. This is, I picked up from Professor Pant of Aerospace Department, IIT Bombay. He presented it. And also, you can see the kind of collaboration people are willing to have with IAST, with various other international agencies. Of course, MIT Madras, and of course, a few more, but then the prominence, in my opinion, these are the ones. So most of them, they have closed links with aerospace organization, and all of them, when the students come out of these institutions, they are very well equipped to take the challenges, whatever I have explained so far. Then, of course, all these institutions, they have the advanced aerospace facilities, but then we need to sort of think and then bring them in a proper manner. It should not be duplicated, but it should sort of complement the other institutions. How do we do that? In fact, that's one of the reasons I keep telling that being in the proximity of VSSC, where the wind tunnel facilities are there, I think IAST should get into certain kind of research and join hands with them, bring a complement facility. And when we visited California Institute of Technology, they didn't have the wind tunnel facility. At some point of time on the rooftop, generally they don't recommend to put the wind tunnel on rooftop, but then they didn't have space, they have put it there. The amount of research that goes on in aerodynamics is something fantastic. That component, the people who are delivering various things, they are always hard pressed with delivering things, not doing research like universities do. Same thing on the combustion research. You know, we went for, when the air breathing was done, to Nikimash, and it is just a very small area and small gadgets and mission, but the kind of research they do is something unique. Same thing on advanced propulsion, structure, control, simulation, you know, all this what we call flexible structure, then the automation, then the different kinds of simulation and space line stuff. All this we need to see where we can lay our hands. I'm mentioning this because IAST is still in the very initial stages of its growth. I think they have to expand with the help of our own friends from ISRO and make it really as a unique organization. And almost all aerospace organizations also, they have close link with research. You know, this is where Professor Satish Dhawan started what we call RESPOND program, and it's going in a very, very nice manner. Only thing is, we need to sort of promote the strong bond between these two organizations, not just like that. You know, I think sometimes we tend to think that what they do is, what is that we are gaining? I don't think you need to look at it. The knowledge base is knowledge base, whether it is really helping us or someone else in the universe. I think we should not. That's why we have to spur the advanced research. We should do that. Then, of course, I would recommend strongly this. I've been telling everywhere. You know, for example, Madras IIT, Bombay IIT, and Institute of Science, they gave on a advanced combustion, combined they come. So that is called Center of Excellence. Similarly, you go to Indian Institute of Science, you have the Wind Tunnel Park, different kinds of one Dr. Reddy, he established it actually. So similarly, you go to, I think, IIT Kanpur, you get on UAVs, a big center, not just doing in a small way. I think that should be termed as center of excellence. That means center of mass has crossed. You add facilities, you add your faculty, then the work goes on in that direction. So, of course, we have to keep in mind the technological relevance to meet the futuristic. This is where I keep telling that the interaction between IIST and ISRO centers, or interaction between Caltech and JPL, what it has done is they are able to sort of always tie up their developments to the futurist technological and programmatic needs, and also develop the system. They are mutually sort of complementary. This is if we do, you know, the kind of that work that you are going to do is something almost at one end of the spectrum. That is important, actually. This is the last. So what I feel is the aerospace developments, if you look at the country in the last 3 to 4, although we are talking 75 years, has really progressed so fast. It's moving in the exponential direction. And more or less, we have attained self-sufficiency in some, maybe on a greater degree, some yet to do. But we are still in the very infant stage is the civil aircraft. I think this is where we have been pushing very hard, how we can take up. I tell you, the kind of import country will have down the line from now to another 10 years, 15 years, 20 years is phenomenal. It's all in what they term as the lakh crores, you know, 5 lakh crore, 10 lakh crore of that order, actually. And of course, all of them, what I mentioned today, I'm very happy to mention that they are all pressed into services. Not only that, we are trying to sort of take it for export. Now with the Atmanirbhar Bharat, what has been sort of propagated is something, a very unique system, and make in India. I think these are all going to go in a big way in the coming maybe another 20, 30 years. And of course, in all this aerospace, I brought out clearly what is the advanced requirement for the country. I think they're all well defined. Maybe it may require further tuning, further changes, and development activities also are going on. So that I want to tell to our youngsters that whatever is there as future is very, very exciting and challenging. So don't get disheartened. You know, people may be launching PSLE, may be launching INSAT, but then I think we have to come out with the newer and newer ideas. And particularly I'm saying this because with the space sector reforms, whatever is brought, you are relieved of the production of the routine production of various things that will go to industry. May happen today, may happen tomorrow, may happen day after, doesn't matter. But then we will be relieved and we can really carry on research more and more. Of course, similarly, industries have grown today, both public and private. Well, that's why I'm saying, you know, the full scale production. We have been talking for decades now, PSLV production will be launched by industry, but yet to happen. But then we need to see how to really give a thrust and make it happen. That's important. Then, of course, this is one area I keep always pressurizing, that interaction and participation by the academia and R&D institutions help to accelerate. You know, whenever we do certain things and then see the product that's coming out, which helps the nation, I think we should feel proud of it. All aerospace education institutions have been importing, and I mentioned already, and today we don't need to go anywhere to get the basic knowledge of aerospace. They are all available in the country. Maybe we will have to sort of harness much more and then see what is lacking and make it good. I think that is what is required. Already I mentioned space sector reforms have brought to attract private operators, so that, you know, space activities will multiply, and the manpower requirement for aerospace scientists, engineers, that also will increase many fold, because once it's not just the private operators will come and then start doing. Already many of the startups, many of the companies, they are taking people, and I understand even some of the IIST students are working in some of these newer startups. Really, it's going to multiply. So there you can see that how they are connected. So before I conclude, I would like to mention that this is it's not just anything, my original idea. It's basically the collection of the whole gamut of developments which haven't happened in the country. Only as fortunate to have had opportunity to interact with them, work with them, and understand them. So you can see the organization that is involved, from ADA, NAL, DRDL, RCA, ADA, BrahMos, there is in the Balasore range. Similarly, our own units from ISRO. Then, of course, also our interaction with IITs, IISc, IIST, and Swinmore University. So with this, I conclude, and I hope you are able to understand and get what has happened in the aerospace in the last, I said since independence, because now we have to think, what are you going to do before we hit a century, next 25 years, what we are going to do. I think you have to come out with the roadmap, and all youngsters who are listening, I can tell you that you have tremendous excitement ahead of you and wish you all the very best. Let me thank the organizers, particularly Director IAST, the Registrar IAST, Professor Purvilla, and all others from IAST and administration for this nice opportunity. Thank you very much and wish you once again greetings on this Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, and come out with bright colors when you hit the century. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes, it's my proud privilege on behalf of IAST to propose a formal vote of thanks. Sir, you are able to hear me now, sir?
Yeah, I'm able to hear.
Okay. Yes, sir. So, first of all, I would like to thank our Honorable Chancellor, Dr. B.N. Suresh, sir, to give a very, very passionate and pursuing talk on because as we are celebrating our Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, what are the accomplishments which has been done by major institutions in the country in the area of aerospace, specifically looking at aeronautics and astronautics, and then how we are positioned and what is the future, how it is bright. As usual, sir, you have ignited many minds and given them big targets, not only for the students which you wanted to address, but also the faculty, and also thankful for other ISRO Center directors also to give a message to all their colleagues who are interested to participate and give this wide audience so that they can be interested and then they can look forward. Thank you very much, sir, from all my colleagues. I thank you once again profusely for that.
Thank you.
And also I would like to thank our director, Sri Somnath. He has given us guidance and he was there physically here with us today, scheduling for your talk, which is very important from the celebrations what we are doing here. Thank you, Somnath ji, for your kind presence and being with us. And also Dr. Purvilla and also my other colleagues who made all it possible with all the support which is needed, and also to all the other center units, my faculty and the staff who are part of this and participating. Thank you, one thing and all, and thank you once again, sir. Namaste, sir.
Namaste.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye, sir.